A Night on the Divide. By Bret Harte. With the lulling of the wind towards evening it came on to snow heavily, in straight, quickly succeeding flakes, dropping like white lances from the sky. This was followed by the usual Sierran phenomenon. The deep gorge, which, as the sun went down, had lapsed into darkness, presently began to reappear. At first the vanished trail came back as a vividly whitening streak before them, then the larches and pines that ascended from it like buttresses against the hillsides glimmered in ghostly distinctness, until at last the two slopes curved out of the darkness as if hewn in marble. For the sudden storm, which extended scarcely 2 miles, had left no trace upon the steep granite face of the high cliffs above, the snow, slipping silently from them, left them still hidden in the obscurity of night. In the vanished landscape the gorge alone stood out, set in a chaos of cloud and storm through which the moonbeams struggled ineffectually. It was this unexpected sight which burst upon the occupants of a large covered station wagon who had chanced upon the lower end of the gorge. Coming from a still lower altitude, they had known nothing of the storm, which had momentarily ceased, but had left a record of its intensity in nearly 2 feet of snow. For some moments the horses floundered and struggled on, in what the travelers believed to be some old forgotten drift or avalanche, until the extent and freshness of the fall became apparent. To add to their difficulties, the storm recommenced, and not comprehending its real character and limit, they did not dare to attempt to return the way they came. To go on, however, was impossible. In this quandary they looked about them in vain for some other exit from the gorge. The sides of that gigantic white furrow terminated in darkness. Hemmed in from the world in all directions, it might have been their tomb. But although they could see nothing beyond their prison walls, they themselves were perfectly visible from the heights above them. And Jack Ten Brook, quartz miner, who was sinking a tunnel in the rocky ledge of shelf above the gorge, stepping out from his cabin at 10 o'clock to take a look at the weather before turning in, could observe quite distinctly the outline of the black wagon, the floundering horses, and the crouching figures by their side, scarcely larger than pygmies on the white surface of the snow, 600 feet below him. Jack had courage and strength, and the good humor that accompanies them, but he contented himself for a few moments with lazily observing the traveler's discomfiture. He had taken in the situation with a glance, he would have helped a brother miner or mountaineer, although he knew that it could only have been drink or bravado that brought him into the gorge in a snowstorm, but it was very evident that these were greenhorns, or eastern tourists, and it served their stupidity and arrogance right. He remembered also how he, having once helped an eastern visitor catch the mustang that had bucked him, had been called my man, and presented with $5, he recalled how he had once spread the humble resources of his cabin before some straying members of the San Francisco party who were opening the new railroad, and heard the audible wonder of a lady that a civilized being could live so coarsely. With these recollections in his mind, he managed to survey the distant struggling horses with a fine sense of humor, not unmixed with self-righteousness. There was no real danger in the situation, it meant at the worst a delay and a camping in the snow till morning, when he would go down to their assistance. They had a spacious traveling equipage, and were, no doubt, well supplied with furs, robes, and provisions for a several hours' journey. His own pork barrel was quite empty, and his blankets worn. He half smiled, extended his long arms in a decided yawn, and turned back into his cabin to go to bed. Then he cast a final glance around the interior. Everything was all right, his loaded rifle stood against the wall, he had just raked ashes over the embers of his fire to keep it intact till morning. Only one thing slightly troubled him, a grizzly bear, two-thirds grown, but only half-tamed, which had been given to him by a young lady named Miggles, when that charming and historic girl had decided to accompany her paralytic lover to the San Francisco hospital, was missing that evening. It had been its regular habit to come to the door every night for some sweet biscuit or sugar before going to its lair in the underbrush behind the cabin. Everybody knew it along the length and breadth of Hemlock Ridge, as well as the fact of its being a legacy from the fair exile. No rifle had ever yet been raised against its lazy bulk or the stupid, small-eyed head and ruff of circling hairs made more erect by its well-worn leather collar. Consoling himself with the thought that the storm had probably delayed its return, Jack took off his coat and threw it on his bunk. But from thinking of the storm, his thoughts naturally returned again to the impeded travelers below him, and he half mechanically stepped out in his shirt sleeves for a final look at them. But here something occurred that changed his resolution entirely. He had previously noticed only the three foreshortened, crawling figures around the now stationary wagon bulk. They were now apparently making arrangements to camp for the night. But another figure had been added to the group, and as it stood perched upon a wagon seat laid on the snow, Jack could see that its outline was not bifurcated like the others. But even that general suggestion was not needed. The little head, the symmetrical curves visible even at that distance, were quite enough to indicate that it was a woman. The easy smile faded from Jack's face, and was succeeded by a look of concern and then of resignation. He had no choice now, he must go. There was a woman there, and that settled it. Yet he had arrived at this conclusion from no sense of gallantry, nor, indeed, of chivalrous transport, but as a matter of simple duty to the sex. He was giving up his sleep, was going down 600 feet of steep trail to offer his services during the rest of the night as much as a matter of course as an Eastern man would have offered his seat in an omnibus to a woman, and with as little expectation of return for his courtesy. Having resumed his coat, with a bottle of whiskey thrust into its pocket, he put on a pair of India rubber boots reaching to his thighs, and, catching the blanket from his bunk, started with an axe and shovel on his shoulder on his downward journey. When the distance was half completed, he shouted to the travelers below. The cry was joyously answered by the three men. He saw the fourth figure, now unmistakably that of a slender youthful woman, in a cloak, helped back into the wagon, as if deliverance was now sure and immediate. But Jack, on arriving, speedily dissipated that elusive hope. They could only get through the gorge by taking off the wheels of the wagon, placing the axle on rude sledge runners of split saplings, which, with their assistance, he would fashion in a couple of hours at his cabin and bring down to the gorge. The only other alternative would be for them to come to his cabin and remain there while he went for assistance to the nearest station, but that would take several hours and necessitate a double journey for the sledge if he was lucky enough to find one. The party quickly acquiesced in Jack's first suggestion. "Very well," said Jack, "then there's no time to be lost. Unhitch your horses and we'll dig a hole in that bank for them to stand in out of the snow." This was speedily done. "Now," continued Jack, "you'll just follow me up to my cabin. It's a pretty tough climb, but I'll want your help to bring down the runners." Here the man who seemed to be the head of the party, of middle age and a superior, professional type, for the first time hesitated. "I forgot to say that there is a lady with us, my daughter," he began, glancing towards the wagon. "I reckoned as much," interrupted Jack simply, "and I allowed to carry her up myself the roughest part of the way. She can make herself warm and comfortably in the cabin until we've got the runners ready." "You hear what our friend says, Amy," suggested the gentleman, appealingly, to the closed leather curtains of the wagon. There was a pause. The curtain was suddenly drawn aside, and a charming little head and shoulders, furred to the throat and topped with a bewitching velvet cap, were thrust out. In the obscurity little could be seen of the girl's features, but there was a certain willfulness and impatience in her attitude. Being in the shadow, she had the advantage of the others, particularly of Jack, as his figure was fully revealed in the moonlight against the snowbank. Her eyes rested for a moment on his high boots, his heavy mustache, so long as to mingle with the unkempt locks which fell over his broad shoulders, on his huge red hands streaked with black grease from the wagon wheels, and some blood, stanched with snow, drawn from bruises in cutting out brambles in the brush, on more awful than all a monstrous, shiny specimen gold ring encircling one of his fingers on the whiskey bottle that shamelessly bulged from his side pocket, and then slowly dropped. Her dissatisfied eyelids. "Why can't I stay here?" she said languidly. "It's quite nice and comfortable." "Because we can't leave you alone, and we must go with this gentleman to help him. Miss Amy let the tail of her eye again creep shudderingly over this impossible Jack. I thought that the gentleman was going to help us, she said dryly. Nonsense, Amy, you don't understand, said her father impatiently. This gentleman is kind enough to offer to make some sledge runners for us at his cabin, and we must help him. But I can stay here while you go. I'm not afraid. Yes, but you're alone here, and something might happen. Nothing could happen, interrupted Jack, quickly and cheerfully. He had flushed at first, but he was now considering that the carrying of a lady as expensively attired and apparently as delicate and particular as this one might be somewhat difficult. There's nothing that would hurt yet here, he continued, addressing the velvet cap and furred throat in the darkness, and if there was it couldn't get at ye, Bane, so to speak, in the same sort o' fix as you. So you're all right, he added positively. Inconsistently enough, the young lady did not accept this as gratefully as might have been imagined, but Jack did not see the slight flash of her eye as, ignoring him, she replied markedly to her father, I'd much rather stop here, Papa. And, continued Jack, turning also to her father, you can keep the wagon and the whole gorge in sight from the trail all the way up. So you can see that everything's all right. Why, I saw you from the first. He stopped awkwardly, and added, come along, the sooner we're off the quicker the job's over. Pray don't delay the gentleman and the job, said Miss Amy sweetly. Reassured by Jack's last suggestion, her father followed him with the driver and the second man of the party, a youngish and somewhat undistinctive individual, but to whose gallant anxieties Miss Amy responded effusively. Nevertheless, the young lady had especially noted Jack's confession that he had seen them when they first entered the gorge. And I suppose, she added to herself mentally, that he sat there with his boozing companions, laughing and jeering at our struggles. But when the sound of her companions' voices died away, and their figures were swallowed up in the darkness behind the snow, she forgot all this, and much else that was mundane and frivolous, in the impressive and majestic solitude which seemed to descend upon her from the obscurity above. At first it was accompanied with a slight thrill of vague fear, but this passed presently into that profound peace which the mountains alone can give their lonely or perturbed children. It seemed to her that nature was never the same, on the great plains where men and cities always loomed into such ridiculous proportions, as when the great mother raised herself to comfort them with smiling hillsides, or encompassed them and drew them closer in the loving arms of her mountains. The long white Canada stretched before her in a purity that did not seem of the earth, the vague bulk of the mountains rose on either side of her in a mystery that was not of this life. Yet it was not oppressive, neither was its restfulness and quiet suggestive of obliviousness and slumber, on the contrary, the highly rarefied air seemed to give additional keenness to her senses, her hearing had become singularly acute, her eyesight pierced the uttermost extremity of the gorge, lit by the full moon that occasionally shone through slowly drifting clouds. Her nerves thrilled with a delicious sense of freedom and a strange desire to run or climb. It seemed to her, in her exalted fancy, that these solitudes should be peopled only by a kingly race, and not by such gross and material churls as this mountaineer who helped them. And, I grieve to say, writing of an idealist that was, and a heroine that is to be, she was getting outrageously hungry. There were a few biscuits in her traveling bag, and she remembered that she had been presented with a small jar of California honey at San Jose. This she took out and opened on the seat before her, and spreading the honey on the biscuits, ate them with a keen schoolgirl relish and a pleasant suggestion of a sylvan picnic in spite of the cold. It was all very strange, quite an experience for her to speak of afterwards. People would hardly believe that she had spent an hour or two, all alone, in a deserted wagon in a mountain snow pass. It was an adventure such as one reads of in the magazines. Only something was lacking which the magazines always supplied, something heroic, something done by somebody. If that awful-looking mountaineer, that man with the long hair and mustache, and that horrible gold ring, why such a ring, was only different. But he was probably gorging beefsteak or venison with her father, and Mr. Waterhouse men were always such selfish creatures, and had quite forgotten all about her. It would have been only decent for them to have brought her down something hot, biscuits and honey were certainly cloying, and somehow didn't agree with the temperature. She was really half-starved. And much they cared. It would just serve them right if something did happen to her or seemed to happen to her, if only to frighten them. And the pretty face that was turned up in the moonlight wore a charming but decided pout. Good gracious, what was that? The horses were either struggling or fighting in their snow shelters. Then one with a frightened neigh broke from its halter and dashed into the road, only to be plunged snorting and helpless into the drifts. Then the other followed. How silly! Something had frightened them. Perhaps only a rabbit or a mole, horses were such absurdly nervous creatures. However, it is just as well, somebody would see them or hear them. That neigh was quite human and awful, and they would hurry down to see what was the matter. She couldn't be expected to get out and look after the horses in the snow. Anyhow, she wouldn't. She was a good deal safer where she was. It might have been rats or mice about that frightened them. Goodness. She was still watching with curious wonder the continued fright of the animals, when suddenly she felt the wagon half bumped, half lifted from behind. It was such a lazy, deliberate movement that for a moment she thought it came from the party, who had returned noiselessly with the runners. She scrambled over to the back seat, unbuttoned the leather curtain, lifted it, but nothing was to be seen. Consequently, with feminine quickness, she said, "I see you perfectly, Mr. Waterhouse, don't be silly." But at this moment there was another shock to the wagon, and from beneath it arose what at first seemed to her to be an uplifting of the drift itself, but, as the snow was shaken away from its heavy bulk, proved to be the enormous head and shoulders of a bear. Yet even then she was not wholly frightened, for the snout that confronted her had a feeble inoffensiveness. The small eyes were bright with an eager, almost childish curiosity rather than a savage ardor, and the whole attitude of the creature lifted upon its hind legs was circus-like and ludicrous rather than aggressive. She was enabled to say with some dignity, "Go away, shoo," and to wave her luncheon basket at it with exemplary firmness. But here the creature laid one paw on the back seat as if to steady itself, with the singular effect of collapsing the whole side of the wagon, and then opened its mouth as if in some sort of inarticulate reply. But the revelation of its red tongue, its glistening teeth, and, above all, the hot, suggestive fume of its breath, brought the first scream from the lips of Miss Amy. It was real and convincing. The horses joined in it, the three screamed together. The bear hesitated for an instant, then, catching sight of the honey pot on the front seat, which the shrinking back of the young girl had disclosed, he slowly reached forward his other paw and attempted to grasp it. This exceedingly simple movement, however, at once doubled up the front seat, sent the honey pot a dozen feet into the air, and dropped Miss Amy upon her knees in the bed of the wagon. The combined mental and physical shock was too much for her. She instantly and sincerely fainted, the last thing in her ears amidst this wreck of matter being the weep of a bullet and the sharp crack of a rifle. Asterisk, 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 asterisk. She recovered her consciousness in the flickering light of a fire of bark, that played upon the rafters of a roof thatched with bark and upon a floor of strewn and shredded bark. She even suspected she was lying upon a mattress of bark underneath the heavy bearskin she could feel and touch. She had a delicious sense of warmth, and, mingled with this strange spicing of woodland freedom, even a sense of home protection. And surely enough, looking around, she saw her father at her side. He briefly explained the situation. They had been at first attracted by the cry of the frightened horses and their plunging, which they could see distinctly, although they saw nothing else. "But, Mr. Tenbrook." "Mr. Who?" said Amy, staring at the rafters. "The owner of this cabin, the man who helped us," caught up his gun, and, calling us to follow, ran like lightning down the trail. At first we followed blindly, and unknowingly, for we could only see the struggling horses, who, however, seemed to be alone, and the wagon from which you did not seem to have stirred. Then, for the first time, my dear child, we suddenly saw your danger. Imagine how we felt as that hideous brute rose up in the road and began attacking the wagon. We called on Ten Broeck to fire, but for some inconceivable reason he did not, although he still kept running at the top of his speed. Then we heard you shriek.
I didn't shriek, Papa, it was the horses.
My child, I knew your voice.
Well, it was only a very little scream because I had tumbled.
The color was coming back rapidly to her pink cheeks.
And, then, at your scream, Ten Broeck fired, it was a wonderful shot for the distance, so everybody says, and killed the bear, though Ten Broeck says it oughtn't to.
I believe he wanted to capture the creature alive.
They've queer notions, those hunters.
And then, as you were unconscious, he brought you up here.
Who brought me?
Ten Broeck, he's as strong as a horse.
Slung you up on his shoulders like a feather pillow.
Oh. And then, as the wagon required some repairing from the brute's attack, we concluded to take it leisurely, and let you rest here for a while.
And where are they?
At work on the wagon.
I determined to stay with you, though you are perfectly safe here.
I suppose I ought to thank this man, Papa.
Most certainly, though of course, I have already done so.
But he was rather curt in reply.
These half-savage men have such singular ideas.
He said the beast would never have attacked you except for the honeypot which it scented.
That's absurd.
Then it's all my fault.
Nonsense.
How could you know?
And I've made all this trouble.
And frightened the horses.
And spoiled the wagon.
And made the man run down and bring me up here when he didn't want to.
My dear child.
Don't be idiotic.
Amy.
Well, really.
For the idiotic one was really wiping two large tears from her lovely blue eyes.
She subsided into an ominous silence, broken by a single sniffle.
Try to go to sleep, dear, you've had quite a shock to your nerves, added her father soothingly.
She continued silent, but not sleeping.
I smell coffee.
Yes, dear.
You've been having coffee, Papa.
We did have some, I think, said the wretched man apologetically, though why he could not determine.
Before I came up, while the bear was trying to eat me.
No, after.
I've a horrid taste in my mouth.
It's the honey.
I'll never eat honey again.
Never.
Perhaps it's the whiskey.
What?
The whiskey.
You were quite faint and chilled, you know.
We gave you some.
Out of that black bottle.
Yes.
Another silence.
I'd like some coffee.
I don't think he'd begrudge me that, if he did save my life.
I dare say there's some left.
Her father at once bestirred himself and presently brought her some coffee in a tin cup. It was part of Miss Amy's rapid convalescence, or equally of her debilitated condition, that she made no comment on the vessel. She lay for some moments looking curiously around the cabin. She had no doubt it had a worse look in the daylight, but somehow the firelight brought out a wondrous luxury of color in the bark floor and thatching. Besides, it was not smelly, as she feared it would be. On the contrary, the spicy aroma of the woods was always dominant. She remembered that it was this that always made a greasy, oily picnic tolerable. She raised herself on her elbow, seeing which her father continued confidently, "Perhaps, dear, if you sat up for a few moments you might be strong enough presently to walk down with me to the wagon. It would save time."
Amy instantly lay down again.
"I don't know what you can be thinking of, Papa. After this shock really I don't feel as if I could stand alone, much less walk. But, of course," with pathetic resignation, "if you and Mr. Waterhouse supported me, perhaps I might crawl a few steps at a time."
"Nonsense, Amy.
Of course, this man Ten Broeck will carry you down as he brought you up.
Only I thought, but there are steps, they're coming now."
"No, only he." The sound of crackling in the underbrush was followed by a momentary darkening of the open door of the cabin. It was the tall figure of the mountaineer. But he did not even make the pretense of entering,
Standing at the door, he delivered his news to the interior generally. It was to the effect that everything was ready, and the two other men were even then harnessing the horses. Then he drew back into the darkness.
"Papa," said Amy, in a sudden frightened voice, "I've lost my bracelet."
"Haven't you dropped it somewhere there in the bunk?" asked her father.
"No. It's on the floor of the wagon. I remember now, it fell off when I tumbled. And it will be trodden upon and crushed.
Couldn't you run down, ahead of me, and warn them, Papa, dear?
Mr. Tenbrook will have to go so slowly with me."
She tumbled out of the bunk with singular alacrity, shook herself and her skirts into instantaneous gracefulness, and fitted the velvet cap on her straying hair. Then she said hurriedly, "Run quick, Papa dear, and as you go, call him in and say I am quite ready." Thus adjured, the obedient parent disappeared in the darkness. With him also disappeared Miss Amy's singular alacrity. Sitting down carefully again on the edge of the bunk, she leaned against the post with a certain indefinable languor that was as touching as it was graceful. I need not tell any feminine readers that there was no dissimulation in all this, no coquetry, no ostentation, and that the young girl was perfectly sincere. But the masculine reader might like to know that the simple fact was that, since she had regained consciousness, she had been filled with remorse for her capricious and ungenerous rejection of Tenbrook's proffered service. More than that, she felt she had perilled her life in that moment of folly, and that this man, this hero, had saved her. For hero he was, even if he did not fulfill her ideal, it was only she that was not a heroine. Perhaps if he had been more like what she wished, she would have felt this less keenly. Love leaves little room for the exercise of moral ethics. So Miss Amy Forrester, being a good girl at bottom, and not exactly loving this man, felt towards him a frank and tender consideration which a more romantic passion would have shrunk from showing. Consequently, when Tenbrook entered a moment later, he found Amy paler and more thoughtful, but, as he fancied, much prettier than before, looking up at him with eyes of the sincerest solicitude. Nevertheless, he remained standing near the door, as if indicating a possible intrusion, his face wearing a look of lowering abstraction. It struck her that this might be the effect of his long hair and general uncouthness, and this only spurred her to a fuller recognition of his other qualities. "I am afraid," she began, with a charming embarrassment, "that instead of resting satisfied with your kindness in carrying me up here, I will have to burden you again with my dreadful weakness, and ask you to carry me down also. But all this seems so little after what you have just done, and for which I can never, never hope to thank you." She clasped her two little hands together, holding her gloves between, and brought them down upon her lap in a gesture as prettily helpless as it was unaffected. "I have done scarcely anything," he said, glancing away towards the fire, "and your father has thanked me. You have saved my life."
"No, no," he said quickly.
"Not that? You were in no danger, except from my rifle, had I missed."
"I see," she said eagerly, with a little posthumous thrill at having been after all a kind of heroine, "and it was a wonderful shot, for you were so careful not to touch me."
"Please don't say any more," he said, with a slight movement of half-awkwardness, half-impatience. "It was a rough job, but it's over now." He stopped and chafed his red hands abstractedly together. She could see that he had evidently just washed them, and the glaring ring was more in evidence than ever. But the thought gave her an inspiration. "You'll at least let me shake hands with you," she said, extending both her own with childish frankness.
"Hold on, Miss Forrester," he said, with sudden desperation. "It ain't the square thing. Look here. I can't play this thing on you, I can't let you play it on me any longer. You weren't in any danger, you never were. That bear was only a half-wild thing I helped to rear myself. It's taken sugar from my hand night after night at the door of this cabin, as it might have taken it from yours here if it was alive now. It slept night after night in the brush, not 50 yards away. The morning's never come yet till now," he said hastily, to cover an odd break in his voice,
when it didn't brush along the whole side of this cabin to kinder wake me up and say so long, afore it browsed away into the canyon. Dar ain't a man along the whole divide who didn't know it, dar ain't a man along the whole divide that would have drawn a bead or pulled a trigger on it till now. It never had an enemy but the bees, it never even knew why horses and cattle were frightened of it. It wasn't much of a pet, you'd say, Miss Forrester, it wasn't much to meet a lady's eye, but we of the woods must take our friends where we find em and of our own kind. It ain't no fault of yours, miss, that you didn't know it, it ain't no fault of yours what happened, but when it comes to your thanking me for it, why it's rather rough, you see and gets me. He stopped short as desperately and as abruptly as he had begun, and stared blankly at the fire. A wave of pity and shame swept over the young girl and left its high tide on her cheek. But even then it was closely followed by the feminine instinct of defense and defiance. The real hero, the gentleman, she reasoned bitterly, would have spared her all this knowledge. But why, she said, with knitted brows, why, if you knew it was so precious and so harmless, why did you fire upon it? Because, he said almost fiercely, turning upon her, because you screamed, and then I knew it had frightened you. He stopped instantly as she momentarily recoiled from him, but the very brusqueness of his action had dislodged a tear from his dark eyes that fell warm on the back of her hand, and seemed to blot out the indignity. Listen, miss, he went on hurriedly, as if to cover up his momentary unmanliness. I knew the bear was missing tonight, and when I heard the horses scurrying about I reckoned what was up. I knew no harm could come to you, for the horses were unharnessed and away from the wagon. I pelted down that trail ahead of them all like grim death, calculatin' to get there before the bear, they wouldn't have understood me, I was too high up to call to the creature when he did come out, and I kinder hoped you wouldn't see him. Even when he turned towards the wagon, I knew it wasn't you he was after, but suthin' else, and I kinder hoped, miss, that you, being different and quicker-minded than the rest, would see it too. All the while them folks were yellin' behind me to fire as if I didn't know my work. I was halfway down and then you screamed. And then I forgot everything but standing clear of hitting you and I fired. I was that savage that I wanted to believe that he'd gone mad, and would have touched you, till I got down there and found the honeypot lying alongside of him. But there it's all over now. I wouldn't have let on a word to you only I couldn't bear to take your thanks for it, and I couldn't bear to have you thinking me a brute for dodging them. He stopped, walked to the fire, leaned against the chimney under the shallow pretext of kicking the dull embers into a blaze, which, however, had only the effect of revealing his two glistening eyes as he turned back again and came towards her. Well, he said, with an ineffectual laugh, it's all over now, it's all in the day's work, I reckon, and now, miss, if you're ready, and will just fix yourself your own way so as to ride easy, I'll carry you down. And slightly bending his strong figure, he dropped on one knee beside her with extended arms. Now it is one thing to be carried up a hill in temperate, unconscious blood and practical business fashion by a tall, powerful man with steadfast, glowering eyes, but quite another thing to be carried down again by the same man, who has been crying, and when you are conscious that you are going to cry too, and your tears may be apt to mingle. So Miss Amy Forrester said, oh, wait, please. Sit down a moment. Oh, Mr. Tenbrook, I am so very, very sorry, and, clapping her hand to her eyes, burst into tears. Oh, please, please don't, Miss Forrester, said Jack, sitting down on the end of the bunk with frightened eyes, please don't do that. It ain't worth it. I'm only a brute to have said anything. No, no. You are so noble, so forgiving, sobbed Miss Forrester, and I have made you go and kill the only thing you cared for, that was all your own. No, miss, not all my own, either, and that makes it so rough. For it was only left in trust with me by a friend. It was her only companion. Her only companion, echoed Miss Forrester, sharply lifting her bowed head. Except, said Jack hurriedly, miscomprehending the emphasis with masculine fatuity, accept the dying man for whom she lived and sacrificed her whole life. She gave me this ring, to always remind me of my trust. I suppose, he added ruefully, looking down upon it, it's no use now. I'd better take it off. Then Amy eyed the monstrous object with angelic simplicity. I certainly should, she said with infinite sweetness, it would only remind you of your loss. But, she added, with a sudden, swift, imploring look of her blue eyes, if you could part with it to me, it would be such a reminder and token of your forgiveness. Jack instantly handed it to her. And now, he said, let me carry you down. I think, she said hesitatingly, that I had better try to walk, and she rose to her feet. Then I shall know that you have not forgiven me, said Jack sadly. But I have no right to trouble. Alas! She had no time to finish her polite objection, for the next moment she felt herself lifted in the air, smelled the bark thatch within an inch of her nose, saw the firelight vanish behind her, and subsiding into his curved arms as in a hammock, the two passed forth into the night together. I can't find your bracelet anywhere, Amy, said her father, when they reached the wagon. It was on the floor in the lint, said Amy reproachfully. But, of course, you never thought of that. ... My pen halts with some diffidence between two conclusions to this voracious chronicle. As they agree in result, though not in theory or intention, I may venture to give them both. To one coming from the lips of the charming heroine herself, I naturally yield the precedence. Oh, the bear story. I don't really remember whether that was before I was engaged to John or after. But I had known him for some time. Father introduced him at the governor's ball at Sacramento. Let me see, I think it was in the winter of 56. Yes. It was very amusing. I always used to charge John with having trained that bear to attack our carriage so that he might come in as a hero. Oh, of course, there are 100 absurd stories about him. They used to say that he lived all alone in a cabin like a savage, and all that sort of thing, and was a friend of a dubious woman in the locality, whom the common people made a heroine of Miggles, or Wiggles, or some such preposterous name. But look at John there, can you conceive it? The listener, glancing at a very handsome, clean-shaven fellow, faultlessly attired, could not conceive such an absurdity. So I therefore simply give the opinion of Joshua Bixley, superintendent of the Long Divide Tunnel Company, for what it is worth. I never took much stock in that bear story, and its captivating old forester's daughter. Old Forrester knew a thing or two, and when he was out here consolidating tunnels, he found out that Jack Tenbrook was about headed for the big lead, and brought him out and introduced him to Amy. You see, Jack, clear grit as he was mighty rough style, and about as simple as they make 'em, and they had to get up something to account for that girl's taking a shine to him. But they seem to be happy enough, and what are you going to do about it? And I transfer this philosophic query to the reader.